Today's title is The Hungry Winter of 1941-42. Hungry winter is, of course, an understatement. The Russian word for hunger is the same as the word for starvation, I think, golod. In English we have two words. But the term hungry winter is known to historians, and has been, well, for a long time, for 70 years, because this was the name that was given, and it was very much in circulation at the time, in respect not of Leningrad, but of the Dutch famine that took place in the autumn and winter of 1944. Those of you who know the history of the Second World War, they know that the Dutch, in order to support the Allied intervention, which of course had happened in Normandy, and the British and Americans and their allies were pushing towards Germany and hoped to make a landing in Holland, the Dutch called a general strike. And for various reasons, basically the abysmal failure of the Market Garden offensive, Montgomery et al., the general strike was a failure, and the Germans punished the Dutch by blockading western Holland. And the Dutch, for several months up until February of 1945, from sort of October through to February, endured starvation, hence the name given to those very, very, very bad months. What is interesting is the figures about the deaths caused by what happened in the hungry winter of the Netherlands in 1944-45. Demographers calculate, and this famine has been very, very closely studied because, as you'd expect, records are plentiful in Holland. Altogether, the number of excess deaths in the Dutch famine, and the population involved was about 50% higher than in Leningrad during the siege. 18,000 people died of starvation in the hungry winter of the Netherlands. Well, we all know what the figures of deaths in the Leningrad famine were colossal and out of all comparison to what happened in the hungry winter in the Netherlands. Thank God for the Dutch. As I said in my introductory remarks last Thursday, estimates of deaths during just the winter of 1941-42, which was the worst period of the siege, even though the siege would go on for 872 days, estimates are in the region of 500,000, half a million, perhaps 600,000, 650,000 total deaths. And of course, people went on dying even after the worst of the blockade had finished, because supplies were able to get through. But total deaths were somewhere between 800,000 and 1.1 million. When you add the deaths of combatants, because the battle for Leningrad was going on at the same time as the siege, and the Red Army was fighting, of course, the Wehrmacht and the Finnish army, total casualties in that could well have been 500,000 total Soviet casualties. So we're looking at a death toll in Leningrad altogether of 1.5 million, if not more. The, of course, death from famine was neither accidental nor was it unique in the case of Leningrad. Millions of people during the Second World War died of famine. And we should remind ourselves that that applied in Asia, in Africa, in the Pacific. It was caused by the policies of the Axis powers, but it was also caused, I'm afraid, by democratic powers. The Bengal famine, for example, during the Second World War, in which probably a couple of million people died, was the direct result of not policy, but of mismanagement of bureaucracy on the part of the British Empire. Even in the Soviet Union, Leningrad was a very specific case of famine, but it's reckoned that something like 4 million people died of famine during the Second World War in the USSR. And they died as a result of policy. It wasn't just that food ran out, it was in certain cities, it was the case that occupation by the Germans was explicitly aimed at expropriating as much of the agricultural surplus as possible, and of course feeding the German army and sending whatever could be sent to Germany. The just the prisoners of war, Soviet prisoners of war, who died were largely starved to death in their camps. At least 3 million of Red Army prisoners died under German control. I spoke last time, just by the by, when I was addressing the question of whether Leningrad might have been spared its fate had the city been declared an open city and had the Red Army retreated from Leningrad, and the population, it's sometimes argued, even now, would have been spared the terrible famine that they did, in fact, have to endure. I pointed out that the fate of those Soviet populations living in the areas adjacent to Leningrad was even worse than what happened in Leningrad itself. Looking at the case, for example, of Pavlovsk, a suburb of Leningrad, there was deliberate starvation of its inhabitants by the occupying forces. Well, let us come to Leningrad and the siege. In the winter of 1941-42, Leningrad experienced famine on a scale unequaled in any city or in any urban setting before or since. It was the worst famine to take place in a major city in the whole of history. With Leningrad besieged by the German and Finnish armies from September 1941, with rations by November 41 at starvation level, and with the population exposed to a bitter winter, at least 500,000 people died just in that winter, and many more subsequently. And let's remind ourselves that these were not combatants, these were civilians who were trapped in the besieged city. And the vast majority, 95% of those who died, died not from the bombing and shelling which Leningrad was continually subjected to for the whole of the siege, but they died from starvation. Leningrad's place in the history of modern famine is distinctive for several reasons. First of all, as I've just indicated, the speed with which famine gripped the population. The blockade began, Leningrad was cut off from direct contact by land from the rest of the USSR in September. In October, there was just about enough food for people to live, although complaints of hunger were more and more heard. By November, the first deaths from starvation were being recorded. And by December 41, the situation was desperate. There were references to an epidemic of starvation. And in January, February, March, through to April, the situation got even worse. The second thing about the famine in Leningrad during the hungry winter was the intensity of the famine, the exceptionally high death rate from December through to April. In February, the death rate, if you can get your mind round this figure, reached an annualized rate, that is, at the rate at which people were dying in those early months of 1941, the rate was 787 per 1,000 of the population. If the famine had continued for the whole of that year, then 787 out of every 1,000 would have died. As it was, about a third of the population, of those who had been living in Leningrad at the start of the siege, died. The third point is, as I've already said, the great majority of those who died, the overwhelming majority of those who died, died from nutritional dystrophy. This is when the body simply shuts down. The organs are so starved, deprived of nutrition, that they just can't function. And the typical way of reaching this point for those sufferers from dystrophy was a sudden death. The body would just shut down. You might be lying in your bed, you might be walking along the street, you might be at work, and you would just suddenly die. And this was the direct consequence of starvation. This is one of the reasons why in descriptions of dystrophiki coming to their tragic end, then they're often described not so much as dying as falling. They would just drop down dead. Another feature of the Leningrad siege to point out is that there was a preponderance of men compared with women. And this is often the case in famine. Women have more body fat, it lasts them longer, although of course not indefinitely. But in the early weeks of starvation, it was men who first succumbed. And the highest rates of death were not among the very old or the very young, but among adolescents, among teenagers, among young men who were already old enough to work, but under the rationing system were treated as dependents. and so got the same very limited ration as, for example, pensioners. And they would at the same time be expending the same amount of energy as workers, and the rations they were on were simply death rations. The other thing to say about the uniqueness of the Leningrad famine is the tremendous volume of evidence we have about how it affected people, how they responded, how the authorities tried to deal with it, and what people's reactions were. I was fortunate, as I mentioned last time, to be part of a major project that was funded by the Wellcome Institute's History of Medicine program, in which a team of Russian historians and medical experts, demographers, etc., collaborated with me in studying the medical records and other records of the siege. And the outcome of this was a book called Life and Death in Leningrad During the Siege. I will again, by the way, distribute just a short list of suggested reading for anyone who wants to follow up anything I've said, and there are a dozen or so books on that if you're interested. Well, the question is, how did state and society react to the immense crisis that engulfed Leningrad in the winter of 41-42? What first has to be said is that the authorities hadn't prepared for this. It is treason to even imagine that an invasion would get as far, anything like as far as Leningrad or Moscow or Kiev. And the reserves in Leningrad were extremely limited, particularly after the main storehouse, the Badaev storehouse or storehouses, were bombed in the early days of the blockade. The authorities, of course, immediately reduced the amount of food issued on the ration, and in the weeks from September, the ration was cut again and again and again. The lowest point during the siege, and this was a point at which there were only 2 or 3 days of grain left in Leningrad, was reached on the 20th of November 1941, when the ration for bread, and often this was the only thing that was distributed, and of course it wasn't pure bread, it was up to half made up of additives, was reduced to 250 grams a day for workers and for engineering technical personnel, and a mere 125 grams for office workers and dependents. I just out of interest, cut myself 125 grams to see what that amounted to. This is what people, if they were dependents, were expected to live on. Well, not expected, but this was what the state provided. That is 125 grams to keep you going for a day, and twice that if you were a worker doing heavy work. There were small increases made from late December, but these were still very minimal rations. And with the opening of the ice road across Lake Ladoga, which permitted evacuation, but it also permitted more supplies to be brought in, then the ration went up. But it was still a long way below what was necessary to support life. It was literally a starvation diet. The calorific value of the workers' bread ration from November 1941, the calorific value was 700. So twice this amount, 700 calories. Well, I'm sure you all know what a norm for subsistence is. This living on 700 calories a day was was a death sentence, unless you could supplement that in one way or another. What, in effect, the state was doing was giving people the possibility of survival, but they were left to their own devices to achieve it. The deputy party leader of Leningrad, Kuznetsov, told a meeting of the City Party Committee on the 9th of January 1942, we must develop independent action on society's part. We must involve people in this. This will help us save people. Otherwise, there is no hope. And the kind of measures that people resorted to, or the state resorted to, took various forms. Canteens at the workplace were opened, and they provided a lifeline for many. Managers kept their employees alive by registering them for workers' ration cards, even if they weren't workers, to give them a bit more of this minuscule diet. Factories and institutes of all kinds set up so-called stationari, convalescence centres, where sick employees were given marginally larger rations together with medical care and given some chance of recovering, although many died nonetheless. But for the most part, the struggle for survival was waged by individuals and in a setting where the familiar amenities and services of a modern urban environment had disappeared. Almost all the electricity generators stopped working in December, and Leningrad virtually ground to a halt. For the rest of what turned out to be a brutal, brutally cold winter, houses had no electricity, no lighting, no heating, no water, no sewerage, no telephones, and people were left to their own devices. The only light was from kerosene lamps, if they could get fuel for that, and for the tiny wood-burning stoves, the bujriki. As one woman noted in her diary, we are living the primitive life of savages on an uninhabited island, cut off from the rest of the world. Another wrote, this is like a medieval plague. But there is no hope. Well, people adopted many different strategies to survive. Artificial markets or on the black market, they sold whatever they could to get food. Clothes, furniture, jewellery, blood, sex. They ate anything they could lay their hands on. Cats and dogs, birds, rats. As the artist, I think, in her interview said, oh no, no, it was Larissa, wasn't
Larissa
it?
Custom,
it was
yeah.
Larissa Huxley, who said that cats, she was a young girl during the siege, cats were the most tasty thing that was going. And of course all sorts of surrogates were used to provide nutrition, bone meal, cellulose, carpenter's glue, bark from trees, fats of all kinds. And some turned to other means. There was a sharp increase in crime. much of it food related, and often this involved those whose situation was desperate in the extreme. Prominent amongst arrested criminals who were caught stealing bread or mugging people in order to get it were refugees from neighbouring regions or from the Baltic republics who were living illegally in Leningrad and as such were not entitled to ration cards. Or again, deserters from the front who were in hiding in the city. Or homeless children whose parents had died and who were, there's presumably, orphans. And understandably, in order to preserve themselves, then people like this, as well as others who had ration cards but were starving, engaged in theft and raids on food shops or stopping delivery vehicles or just stealing from anyone who was weak and could not defend themselves. And of course, and I'm sure you have seen reference to this, the most anti-social, literally kind of crime in the form of cannibalism became, we don't know how common a feature, but it was certainly referred to in all the diaries that people kept, and it's also there in official reports. As one district police chief wrote, at the end of the winter of 41-42, there were many cases where a child killed his parents, or parents their child, or neighbours killed one another, or where people ate corpses. It's clear from the sources I've mentioned that cannibalism was not a rare phenomenon. Official figures showed that hundreds of people were arrested for cannibalism in January, February and March. What's interesting is that two-thirds of those arrested were women. It's true the majority of the population, the civilian population, were women because many men were at the front. And women had responsibility for their starving children, but that is the case. 5/6 of those who were arrested for cannibalism were from outside Leningrad. This refers to the refugees I mentioned. And here we're talking about overt cannibalism, either killing others for the human meat or eating the flesh of corpses. This is what I call overt cannibalism, but there must have been much more of what we might refer to as involuntary cannibalism. That is, consuming meat products that were on sale in the market, but which were of very dubious origin. What I now want to come on to say a word about is the impact of these terrible conditions on people's attitudes and behaviour. And here, I've already mentioned, I refer to the work of the sadly late Sergei Yarov. This is his book, Blokada Etika, Morality During the Siege. And this is the one that will be coming out, thanks to Polity, in a few months' time. The sequel to this, and well, we'll see if we can persuade Polity to publish this as well, is called Daily Life in Blockaded Leningrad. Came to terms with what circumstances made them do. This provides detail, sickening detail, of what the conditions in which many, many people were living. I looked at the comments, which you can get on the internet, on readers' comments on this book, and the number of people who said, just reading this made me sick, and I made myself read to the end, but this is a book that anyone should read who wants to have some understanding of the degradation to which appalling circumstances like the siege and the famine in Leningrad can lead people. One of the points that Sergei Yarov explores, I think very revealingly, is the way in which famine heightened mutual dependency within families. Members of the family with access to additional food rations could literally keep other members of the family alive. And these might well be the senior members, the parents, the employed members of the family, but those parents themselves could be in a desperate state, unable to work, unable to get supplementary rations, and quite often it's children who are getting some supplementary food at their school, who bring it home and keep their parents alive. And indeed, interdependence between members of families could continue after death, literally after death. The ration cards of people who had died could still be used, even if this was illegal. But if you didn't register the death of your grandmother or father, but went on using at least during the period of their validity their ration cards, then the deceased could still be keeping the living members of the family alive. I'd like to quote a couple of extracts from diaries kept during the siege. In the first, the diarist records hearing the granddaughter of a dying old woman telling her friend, "My granny just won't die. I can't wait for her to die. At least then we can use her card for a few days before the funeral. I'm just so hungry." And then the second diarist meets a 7-year-old girl who's a neighbour in the bread queue. She was beside herself with joy. She said, "Uncle Arkady, Mummy's died." I said, "Why are you so happy?" "Why? Because I've now got her ration card." The emaciated faces of the whole queue turned and looked at us in horror. Well, I now want to turn to the question of death and coping with death. As I said, calling this winter the hungry winter is an understatement, by far a euphemism virtually. What it was referred to often at the time was Smert’noe vremya, the time of death. And the fact is that Leningrad in the winter of 1941-42 was a city of death. In peacetime, deaths in Leningrad averaged about 3,500 a month. By the beginning of 1942, that many were dying each day, and the numbers went up. by February, 5,000. Some reports would even put it at 10,000, though that's probably an exaggeration. But anyway, many thousand were dying each day. And as well as creating horrific scenes and experiences for those who were still living, this posed overwhelming problems for the authorities who were responsible for disposing of the dead. Even before the famine had started to take its heavy toll, the strain on the funeral service was being felt. In July, i.e. before the siege, 3,500 burials were recorded in Leningrad by the funeral trust. By November, when starvation was starting to get a hold, this number had risen to 11,500. In December, the position changes radically. The graves that had already been dug in autumn in preparation for casualties, because war, of course, had begun in June, were already full. People were now resorting to any means available to bury their dead. The crisis would be described in a report of the funeral trust. The population is forced to turn to private ways of making coffins, to speculators and marauders who demand bread and food. To perform their last duties to their dead people, give away their last crumbs of bread or the ration cards of the deceased, or make a box from doors, old boards, shutters, or simply wrap the corpse up in a sheet or a blanket or just in paper. Coffins, if they were available when people dragged their deceased to the cemetery, would be provided for a certain price. The relatives would say their farewell and depart, and then the cemetery workers would turn the body out, add it to the pile of corpses, and do a deal with the next person who turned up waiting or wanting a coffin. And the situation by January was one of complete chaos in the cemeteries. To quote, cemetery wolves, using others' poverty and helplessness and the lack of official grave diggers, hired themselves out to dig graves. Citizens, grief-stricken, couldn't always wait for the burial, so the wolves would throw the unburied corpses into the cemetery, cover it with paper, a little earth, and consider their job done. The picture is at the on the way to cemeteries is like a horrendous nightmare. One diarist writes, in front of the gates, on the streets, by the cemeteries, but also in offices, or on paths, on gravestones, between them, lie dozens, sometimes hundreds of corpses, in coffins and out of them. The problem for the authorities, of course, was an immense one, the impact of such chaos on public morale and the risk of infection leading to epidemics. The law by which deaths had to be officially registered before interment was abandoned in December, and people were just left to take their deceased to the cemetery if they could, but often they were left in morgues or just on the street. By the beginning of January, the Leningrad Funeral Trust was in a state of total crisis. Hundreds of bodies which had been collected and taken to the cemeteries were just awaiting burial, thousands of bodies. In February at the Peskaryovskoye Cemetery, it was calculated there was literally a mountain of 25,000 unburied bodies. And of course, in this situation, those who were desperate for food of any kind resorted to cannibalism. To quote, "People begin to steal parts of chopped up bodies, particularly those of children." At the Serafinovsky Cemetery, the director and local police inspector discovered a corpse's head that had been cut off. The other parts of the body had been used. The tracks leading to a wooden house on the boundary of the cemetery was where they discovered the inhabitants cooking human flesh. In a woman's bag were the bodies of five children. Skulls were found at cemeteries with their brains extracted. I mean, these are horrific facts, and one of the purposes of Yarov is to get across to people who read his and other accounts of the appalling nature of the situation in which so many people found themselves. A lot, of course, during Soviet times was written, and it's not untrue, about the stoicism, the endurance, the heroism of the inhabitants of Leningrad. But there's another side to the story, and it's a side of unimaginable and unendurable suffering that led people, or some people, to the most extreme measures. There are reports, for example, I mean, the scenes are something I've never read before, was a description in this book of lorries taking corpses from the morgues to the cemeteries. The corpses would be packed in as tightly as possible so you could get as many in one lorry. The most effective way of doing that was to stand the corpses up, because they were frozen anyway because of the winter. So you'd get lorries with literally hundreds of corpses standing, being taken to the cemetery. And the description describes how women's hair would, you know, be blowing in the wind. Or another woman records that she's told by the driver of a five-ton truck that he's got 500 bodies in his truck. And she says, "You can't possibly have that many in your truck." And he says, "Yes, come from the children, so." And so these were the bodies of hundreds of little children. Well, the authorities responded in all sorts of desperate ways, using anywhere that they could to dispose of the dead. Sand quarries, bomb craters, anti-tank ditches. They even improvised crematoria. Can you imagine, you know, a brick factory where the temperature would be high when bricks were being made was converted into a cemetery, the first Leningrad cemetery proper on Moskovsky Prospect was opened on the 7th of March. Well, of course, the hungry winter came to an end eventually in April, March, although the death rate didn't start to fall until May. People who had been subject to the starvation diet, if you can call it that, of the winter, the dystrophiki, were past redemption, and in fact people continued to die of dystrophy, recorded as such up until the end of 1942. But the great surge of deaths is really on the way down by spring. What then, of course, remains is to clean up the city, to clean up the streets and the houses. Thousands of bodies from the snow melts are discovered that had just been lying under mounds of snow. The sanitary situation in the yards and in the houses themselves is beyond description. I won't make you feel sick, but it's all recorded in these books. But the city got its act together. People who were starving still did respond to the command to clean up their apartments, their staircases, their yards, their streets, and the city by the late spring, early summer, was at least in a tolerable state. I may just show you one or two extracts from the film that those of you who want can see on the 6th of February, the Osnitsa film, because it, I think, gives some visual reinforcement of things I've been saying. But what I would really want to end by urging you to do, when the book that I've taken several of these examples from, Yanov's book on the on morality during the siege, is published, which it will be, I think, in June, is to see how this book and its author really challenges us to get a real understanding of what the suffering that war, famine can cause a population. And people who, after all, you know, like us, lived in a modern, in a developed, in a beautiful, in the case of Leningrad, environment. And I think more than this, what Yarov and others like him do is to challenge us to think, what if it were us? How would we respond to appalling conditions like this? How would the ethics of a blockaded Cambridge develop under the kind of horror that Leningrad and its population endured, and in the majority of cases survived, amazingly. About a third of the population was evacuated, but others hung on to life, and once supplies started to come through, it got better. I think it is a real challenge to imagine what kind of choices we would make, because, as Yarov says in numerous examples, when you have the power of life and death, because you are the healthy or still surviving person, and your dependents are in a state of serious decline, then I think it does really make us all think hard as to what choices we in these situations would make, and whether we would have the capacity for endurance that so many who did survive in Leningrad had. Well, I think all this was as background to this wonderful exhibition that we have. And so I'd like to finish by thanking Xenia and Libby, and of course Elena, the artist herself, for making it possible for us to use our imaginations and get some understanding and some grasp of what the siege of Leningrad and what people endure, especially through the hungry winter of 41-42, was. I'll stop there, but of course now there's time for discussion, questions, and any comments that you'd like to make.